No, I will do my best here this morning. It's been a few years since I've preached. Actually, this morning I realized it's been 5 years since I've last preached. I've led a lot of sharing services and things like that, but I haven't actually done this, so I feel a little bit rusty in putting some of this together. It's also very different when you can't like get an amen from anybody. I miss Fred here in these moments, so thank you, Jeff, for that. I heard in about a year, Jeff is looking for more nursery workers. So they're expecting quite a baby boom coming from this whole virus. And so if you're interested in that, maybe sign up with Jeff. And I know he'll be needing more help there. Okay, well, I'll try to get you home in time for lunch today. And we're going to do what we can. So it's exciting to see what the youth are doing with reading through their Bible. I know I have a few girls that are well on their way through this challenge. I think one is going for the ability to shave Scott's head is one of the ultimate prizes if you read the whole Bible in a month. So we'll have to see what Scott's new hairdo is going to look like here in the next while. She's going for it. So Palm Sunday is kind of an exciting Sunday for me. It's actually 14 years ago, I realized in my notes this morning, I preached Palm Sunday once before. And I think what's made it so special is, one, is some of the symbolism that's there. It's full of incredible amount of pictures and just different images that is recorded for us here. And there's so many unique things about this story. But also there's another story for me personally that's kind of special here. And it actually involves a young man here in our church. I'm guessing he's about 11. His name's Caleb Penner. I remember before he was born, I was an elder at the time, and before he was even born, they knew there was an issue. They never thought he'd ever have the ability to walk. And I remember as elders praying over Judith and Ben and Judith and praying for him. And he was probably 3 or 4. I can always picture this, him walking down the aisles Palm Sunday morning, waving the branches. And the palm branch is kind of interesting. We're going to get into that more later. But just this picture of, you know, of hope that was offered in the midst of a sickness that didn't look like it was overcomable. And yet here is a little boy walking and celebrating and praising the Lord for what he has done. Now, I don't always understand why the Lord doesn't always answer our prayers in this way. Sometimes he does. And it is exciting when he does answer, and other times he had other reasons that we don't always understand. But this morning, I guess, just that Palm Sunday was always special for me because I can still picture him in my mind walking up the aisle with a huge smile on his face waving this branch. So let me set the stage for this story a little bit. Jesus here is concluding week of his ministry. He has been ministering for the last years, and now we're entering his final week. So if you're reading through your Bible this week, if you look at from where this story happens, kind of through to the end of the Gospels, and this is recorded in all 4 Gospels, this is like some of his more final words while he's here on earth. So he's being more and more bold, more plain with some of his speaking. A lot of times prior, the things he's been sharing has been more veiled or hidden, and it made sense later. Now he is becoming more and more unveiled in some of the things that he's sharing. And so pay attention to that. So Jesus at this point is about 33 years old, and he's never been on a date. So I told my girls a couple weeks ago, I said, if you can outlive the Lord, then you can start dating. I figured that was a good age. Also, he never had a cell phone until he was, I don't know when he got his first cell phone, but as 33, he didn't have his phone yet. So there is another parenting thing there. Maybe we'll wait till then to get our kids' phones. But he's about 33 years old. He's got a group of 12 disciples, and he now is entering Jerusalem. They're heading to Jerusalem for the Passover. Okay, and so there's lots of pictures here in this story. I'm going to start with, and Jeff read us for us in Mark 11, but the story of he sends the disciples into the village to go and ask or to go and get this donkey. Okay, and it's a colt, actually. It's recorded in all 4 Gospels, and in 2 of the Gospels, it talks about it being a colt. This donkey has never been ridden before. So, why a donkey? Why would Jesus enter Jerusalem riding on a donkey? Never mind just a colt of a donkey, okay, one that had never been ridden before. You know, kings used to enter after a war and after a great victory, they'd enter in on a, like a war horse, you know, this huge, majestic animal that was known for its dominance in so many ways. What's a donkey known for? Well, honestly, it's a symbol of service, suffering, peace, and humility. Never mind a colt of one of these. It's just even more amplified. Is this idea of this picture of him coming to serve, not coming as a dictator and just going to win his way through. He came to serve, to suffer, and he came in peace. So just this picture of that. Also, it speaks a little bit of his sovereignty. I don't know if you've ever ridden an animal that has never been ridden before, but it usually does not go well. I'm sure there's a few of you who have some stories. I have tried it a number of times. Usually, I can't even get on the animal because it's so skittish and fighting. But here you have Jesus riding on this colt that had never been ridden before, and in perfect submission, this thing carries Jesus in. So it's really interesting. And just, you know, we saw Jesus, you know, he spoke to the weather. He calmed the waves and the wind. We've seen him raise people from the dead. You know, just his sovereignty over all these things. But just, again, just speaks to his sovereignty over this. It also speaks to his sovereignty of the people. I mean, they told the disciples just to go and to get this colt. And if somebody says, hey, what are you doing? You know, it says, hey, my master has need of it. Well, you think of today's day and age, it'd be like somebody jumping in someone's truck and somebody says, hey, what are you doing? Says, oh, my boss needs this. Oh, okay. And they just let it go. And here you see the same thing again. So just sovereignty over the situation. It's kind of like in John 18 when Peter, you know, this is when they're in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus is getting arrested and Peter pulls out a sword and actually tries to murder one of the guards. The guard ducks, you know, he cuts off his ear. And here Jesus then, you know, you think at this point Peter is an obviously attempted murderer. He's in lots of trouble. You know, Jesus heals the ear and he tells the guard, let Peter go. And the guard just does. This guy just tried to kill him and he just let him go because Jesus said so. So just kind of speaks to the sovereignty of Christ. And in all these situations, whether it be this donkey, the people letting it go, just how Christ has sovereignty over all circumstances. And I think that's something we should be remembering for today. The idea of the disciples laying their coats over Jesus. Okay, so this is an act of submission. This is an act of a chivalry where, you know, it used to be, you know, there'd be a puddle and you might lay your coat down on somebody or down on the puddle so someone could walk through without getting their feet dirty. This is that idea. They laid their coats in the street so that just kind of as an act of submission. In fact, there's only one other time I can find in Scripture where this is done. And this is back in 2 Kings. And it's King Jehu, who was not particularly a well-loved king, or he was a very violent king. In fact, he is the one who destroyed Jezebel. He is the one who came in and wiped out Ahab and Jezebel and kind of removed that dynasty. Now, Jezebel was the one who had led Israel astray. He came in and he destroyed her. But when he became king, the people laid their coats down before him as he walked in and declared him as king. Now, Jesus, you know, we often wouldn't think of and comparing him to Jehu, but in the sense here, there is something for us to look at. Jesus is coming to destroy the one who is leading us astray. And that's exactly the picture that was back in the Old Testament, and that's the same picture we're seeing here, whether people know it or not, this prophetic declaration of just this act of submission, laying their coats down before Jesus and just submitting to him. The other thing was palm branches. Lots of symbolism in palm branches, both for the Jews in their own culture and within the Roman culture that they would have also been very well versed with. So first of all, palm branches were a symbol of freedom. Okay, they were waved. In fact, only the Gospel of John does it say that they were palm branches. It says in the other Gospels that they were branches. John specifically mentions palm branches. And in the Roman culture, if you were a slave, and if you were going to be ever set free from being a slave, whether you'd be a gladiator or working for somebody, you were given a palm branch. That palm branch was a symbol of your freedom. So here you have the people, you know, they would have been very well versed with the Roman culture because that's what they were living under. You know, taking these palm branches, these symbols of freedom, and basically laying them down and praising the Lord with them. So that was the one side of it. The second side was even from a Jewish perspective, from within their own Judean culture, it was also a symbol from the Feast of Booths or the Feast of Tabernacles. So you can find this in Leviticus 23. It's a festival or a feast where what they would do is they would celebrate the leaving out of Egypt, the leaving slavery, coming out of Egypt. And so on day one, they would take palm branches and they would praise the Lord with them. They would use them in their worship and they would have like a day of rest. They would worship the Lord and they would use palm branches. That was one of the things they do. They would live in these little tents or booths kind of for the week as a symbol or to remind themselves of what it was like to be in Egypt and coming out of it. Then on the eighth day, they would have another Sabbath. And this was like a day of like eternal rest. It was a day of even more celebration and more rest. And this was just the idea of on the eighth day, the Lord rested. He rested from all of this. You know, they would celebrate for 7 days, and then on the eighth day, they would just rest from all this. Now, there's a lot of symbolism here in this whole story. This is Palm Sunday. Now, one thing we got to remember is the Jews counted part of a day as a whole. So they say Jesus was in the grave for 3 days, right? Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. But in all reality, from a Western perspective, we would consider this maybe 30 or 35, 40 hours is likely what he was in the grave. But they would have counted that as 3 days. So Friday would have been the first day, Saturday, and then Sunday they would count as well. So on the Feast of Booths here, what you would have is on the Palm Sunday, you would have the beginning of the first day, then Saturday would be the last day. Okay, so he died on Friday, but then Saturday would be the last day of this festival, and then on Sunday, Easter morning, Sunday, was a day of rest. It's like this eternal rest that just this picture of this is a new, this is what replaces it. This is kind of the fulfillment of this whole feast. It starts here on Palm Sunday, and it ends on Easter morning. And it's this idea of there's nothing at this point on Easter that you can do. What all the work has been done for you. You're set free. You are no longer slaves. You're completely set free. Just like this picture of them leaving Egypt, they are now set free, and they move on from here. So salvation at this point is just a free gift. It is something that's offered to us. Jesus has done that work. He has set us free. The captives have been released. And at this point, we can just rest in that. And that's what Sunday morning, Easter Sunday, is all about. Is this entering this eternal rest that has been offered to us. So it's an incredible
Are we back on? Okay. Not sure how much. Okay. Okay, sorry, we had a little mic die there. So we have this idea here then of Jesus being this eternal rest for us. You know, this feast starts here now on Palm Sunday, the symbol of this feast, and then it ends with the eighth day being Easter Sunday. So that just multiplying this idea of this idea of rest. There's nothing we have to do at this point. It's salvation is a free gift. It's just something we can rest in and rest assured. And that's what they were supposed to do on the eighth day, is just rest from all this slavery that they came out of. Now we start this new life well rested. This picture is also used in Revelation 7. So in John, in John's gospel, he talks about the palm branches. That's also, he also sees this vision in Revelation 7, where it talks about salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. So there's just this picture of multitudes waving palm branches and shouting to the Lord, just like what we see here on Palm Sunday. It's this idea of this declaration of salvation belonging to our God. And they're singing this and they're praising that. So we see this picture both here in this Palm Sunday, but we also see this again in a future date in Revelation 7. So this idea of Hosanna. Hosanna, when they're singing Hosanna here, it says, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Sorry, I find a hard time. I need my hands for talking. Holding a mic is a challenge. Is this idea of this a declaration? Hosanna literally means one of two things. Depends on what tense it is. Lord, save us or save, please. Versus, and the other way is salvation, thank you. So literally translated, this is what the two different meanings would be. Now, in this case, we're seeing it as more of a salvation, thank you. So these people are like declaring Jesus as their Savior, and they're thanking him for their salvation. Now, they may not even have a full grasp of what they're doing, but this is just a complete prophetic picture of what Jesus has done or is about to do as he enters in this last week. So we see this in Psalm 118 as well. This is David, you know, he's like, Lord, his declare is, Lord, save us, give us success in what we're doing. And this is the same kind of declaration that we see here the Jews are doing, is kind of the save us or salvation, thank you for this. And that's what they're singing. They're talking about this coming kingdom. They're recognizing him as the Messiah, and he is the Savior. And that's what this is. This word is not used many times in the gospel, and it is saved for this. So, what does all this do? What is our conclusion of this? The idea of this is that it offers hope. Hope that we can have. There is a hope here that is offered in this picture with all these symbols in this picture of what Jesus did. There is a hope for us that is offered in a dire situation. And I feel like that's what the world needs right now. You know, we think of people are cooped up, they're feeling hopeless, they're scared. A lot of people are living in a lot of fear right now. And that is not what Jesus has to offer. He does not offer fear. He offers hope, which is the opposite of fear. So here, and you have the Jews in a complete dire situation. They are being totally oppressed. You know, they could not worship in freedom. They had all kinds of restrictions on them, and they had no freedom to run as they wanted to. But yet you see Jesus here being this picture of hope. And I feel like for us, that is what is offered. Just like I shared at the beginning of my message about Caleb, you know, and making Palm Sunday special for me by waving that palm branch, you know, a symbol of freedom over sickness. I think that's what God gave this picture to me all those years ago. He's even for right today. There's a picture of sickness around us today. And yet God offers this hope, this healing that can happen, that he would heal our land. He would heal our country, our nation, our continent, our world. You know, that is the whole picture of Palm Sunday, to come and to heal, to release captives, to release healing for all of us, and whatever that might look like. So how should we exactly respond right now? Do we worship him for the same hope that he is offering you? Okay, no matter what your current situation or our current circumstances, I think we can offer people and the people around us and even our own hearts a hope that cannot be shaken from all this. So I want to close with a song here this morning. It's by Matthew West. And Andy's going to cue it up. You guys can listen to it. And then I will close this off.
So this is how it feels when standing strong turns into barely even holding on. The plans you had are shattered on the floor.
when your fear tells your faith, there's no use in praying those prayers anymore. When your world is crashing, when your knees hit the ground, when your heart is asking, what do I do now? Just when you think it can't get worse, hold on, that's when hope returns. Like a new sun breaking through the darkest night, like a whisper saying, it'll be alright. I know you're tired, I know it hurts, but hold on, that's when hope returns.
Let's just close with prayer this morning. Father, we come before you and we're so grateful for the hope that you have to offer us. We thank you for the salvation that you give to us. We thank you for coming as a humble servant. And you lead your people with humility. Father, we just thank you for your willingness to participate in this. And Jesus, for you so willingly going to the cross and suffering on our behalf. Father, I just pray that this week that you would stir in our hearts, the Holy Spirit come and minister to our hearts and reveal the cross to us in a new way. Father, I know that we long to be together again in the physical. And Lord, I just ask that even as we're separated in our own, that you would meet with us, that we would figure out ways to encourage one another and lift each other up. To offer hope to those around us that we're connected with, that we would struggle to otherwise. Father, I just ask that this week that you would just stir within us a joy and excitement, a declaration of praise to you, despite a really hopeless circumstance that we're in right now. So, Father, we just thank you for this opportunity to be together. We thank you for technology like this that we can still meet. And I just ask that you would be with us as we go this week, that we would be hope givers to those around us. Father, we just pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Okay, thanks for watching this morning, and enjoy your week.